the Anglican Way. That's a little picture. Do you all know where that is? It's all, huh? It's Radnor. It's on the dam. Oh, see? It's all fancified, though. Now, I'm going to start pushing things, and then some of you who are towards the back are going to be like, oh, I need to move up because I can't read that text. Watch this. It's going to happen here in a minute. Okay. You don't know where that one is, though, right? Okay. That's Martha's Vineyard. Okay. On the right. But it looks like pretty much everywhere, like everywhere where there's a beach and trees. So here's why this thing is called the Anglican Way. So Jesus is like walking around 2,000 years ago, right? And goes up to people and he says, follow me. And then they just do that, right? I mean, so following Jesus just literally meant, you know, following Jesus. You just got up and walked behind him and then that was it. And so that made you a disciple, just like walking behind this guy. And that is not possible today unless you are living with a hallucinatory Jesus, right, who you walk behind all the time. You cannot, like, walk around following Jesus. And so if we're going to follow Jesus, we're going to have to figure out how exactly that's going to be done. And the way that, I'm going to keep using the word way, the way that that is done for anybody is to walk in a way. In the time of Jesus, rabbis, generally speaking, had a way. They called it halakha, a way of walking. And it was like, so Rabbi so-and-so has this way of walking, and Rabbi so-and-so has this way of walking. They have this sort of, this is the kind of Jewish life we lead, okay? This concept of your faith life is like walking in a road, walking in a way that is laid out for you by masters or by elders or by somebody before you is common to most religion. Okay, and so it's not something that we invented. It is, of course, a metaphor when we say the word way, that we're walking in, because there is no literal way. There's no literal path of Anglicanism. The Anglican way is just a way of being Christian, and that's it. It's not more than that, and it's not really less than that. It is just that. Every Christian has a way. Now, some Christians believe they don't have a way. They think that they're like, you know, following the Holy Spirit, or, you know, that Jesus is like really just driving forward. They're self-deluded. Okay, everyone has a way. Even Pentecostals have a way, right? Even people who are following the Holy Spirit wherever He may lead have a way, because somebody has shown them this is what it means, right? To follow. This is what it means to do this. And so the Anglican way is one of those. It is just a way. It is not my opinion that it is better than any other way. It's not like this is like God's favorite way. It's just my favorite way. Okay? It might be your favorite way, or it might become your favorite way, or you might do this and be like, this is not my favorite way. I don't really care, you know, what your favorite way is. You should just do whatever that is, all right? As long as it's following Jesus, couldn't care less which way that is. Let me use another metaphor that may be helpful, that some people find helpful, and that is a cup. So people who are wine snobs, and you might be one of them, tell me that the kind of glass you pour wine into matters for the drinking of the wine. Have you ever heard this? Have you ever heard of wine snobs? They say this? Okay, so like one day I was at a party and I was holding a glass like this, but I was holding it by the part where the wine sits, not by the stem. And this guy comes up to me and says, no, you have to hold it by the stem. And I said, why? He said, because it changes the flavor of the wine by the heat of your body. I was like, whoa, that you're crazy. But I did it, of course, because I was like, oh, of course. You know, I held it by the stem, and then it felt weird. You know. Why am I bringing this up? Here's why. Because the gospel is like a wine, okay? You can drink wine out of any kind of cup imaginable, right? You can pour wine into a coffee mug, you can pour it into a paper cup, you can pour it into a solo cup, you can pour it into a nice little, you know, glass design for it, whatever it is, the glass or the cup may change the experience of the wine, but it's not going to change the wine into something else, right? Like if I pour wine into a coffee mug, it doesn't suddenly become coffee, okay? So the gospel is always the gospel, regardless of what it's poured into. However, what it's poured into can change the way you receive it. Okay? It can make it a little bit different, okay? And so a way is like is also like a glass for wine. It's like a wine glass. It changes the way you receive it. Okay, so the gospel is always going to be the same, but the way you receive it might be different. Okay. So let me tell you what my thesis is. I have a thesis for this entire 6 weeks, and I'm going to be exploring this thesis. I'm just going to be introducing it to you tonight. Okay, so this image right here is something called the compass rose. The compass rose was invented, it's a logo, it was invented in about 1950 by the dean of St. John the Divine, the Episcopal Cathedral in New York City. But I could be wrong about that, but I think it was by that guy. And what it shows is it's essentially a compass like that you would see on a map, you know, like a seafarer's map. Do you see that? Okay, so it's like a compass on a seafarer's map. And then on the top of it, there is something called a mitre, which is a bishop's hat, and that indicates the hat indicates that what's underneath it is under the authority of bishops. The compass itself, in his estimation, was an indication that the Anglican communion was worldwide, that it went in every single possible direction. And then in the middle of the compass is the cross of St. George, which represents the Church of England, represents the root of the Anglican Church, and also has a kind of, if you look at it a different way, has kind of a heart shape also, if you kind of squint a little bit. And then around the cross of St. George are Greek letters, because we wouldn't want to make it easy for anyone. It's in Greek, and it says, "The truth shall set you free." But it says it in Greek, not in English. Okay, so here's my thesis. My thesis is that the Anglican way can be well represented by this symbol in a larger way than the guy who made this intended. Okay, and my suggestion is that Christians, that every Christian way finds itself on a variety of like spikes off of this thing. That there's like the north and the south, the east, the west, and all these kind of things. And that each one represents a kind of an axis of the way Christians live. And as I go talk about this, I think it'll become more clear. And that the Anglican way is a way that is centered in all of these axes at the same time. Okay, so let me show you, it'll begin to make more sense. So let's talk about the first axis, which is this one right here, right? The horizontal axis. The horizontal axis, I like to think of as like the me to we axis. Okay, so that on the west side, which is the left, everything's about me, and on the right side, which is the east, everything is about we. And I would suggest that Christians who are evangelical in their nature tend to be on the me side of that axis, and Christians who are Catholic in nature tend to be on the we side of that axis. So that if you think of your faith or your religion as essentially about you as an individual, you live over here somewhere. And if you think of your religion as something that's significantly about us, my community, then you're over there somewhere. And that somehow the Anglican way at our best exists somewhere in the middle, somewhere in the tension between those two. Let me unpack that a little bit more, which may be helpful. So if you have ever been around evangelicals, you have probably heard somebody say something like all I need is, you know, me, Jesus, and the Bible, right? That there's a sense on the far side of evangelicalism that Christianity is about my personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Have you heard that expression? Right? You need to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what Christianity is. Okay, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That sounds awesome, but a personal relationship with Jesus Christ does not say much about a corporate relationship with Jesus Christ. Right? So on the evangelical side, you have the personal relationship with Jesus Christ. On the Catholic side, you have a more corporate relationship with Jesus Christ, a more corporate relationship with religion. And so there are folks for whom their spirituality is not about a personal connection or a personal belief, but it's about what my community believes. Okay, a great way to think about this is how does the church think about baptism? Right. So if you're in an evangelical church, what happens if someone's going to get baptized? What happens? Somebody says, "I want to get baptized. Why? Well, because I believe in Jesus. So you want to make Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior? Yes. Well, let's say a prayer. Let's make Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior, and then we're going to baptize you. But the important part was the prayer, right? Personal Lord and Savior prayer. And then the baptism is like kind of like, look, everybody, Billy has decided to follow Jesus. Right? Billy has become a Christian. Yay, Billy, right? But it was his personal decision. So conversations about like age of accountability come up in evangelical churches. Like, what's the age of accountability? Like, you know, how old do you have to be? And, you know, like, how much do you have to know in order to get baptized, right? Like, what are the things you have to know? So maybe you have to go to a class or something. You have to learn something, right, in the evangelical side. In the Catholic side of faith, what happens if someone's going to be baptized? Well, generally speaking, mom and dad decide that the baby's going to be baptized, right? And so mom and dad take the baby to church. Priest puts water in the baby's head, baptizes them in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Does the baby have any personal decision made? No, right? The baby has made no personal decision. But the community has decided that the community's faith is good enough. Right, so the communal faith of the parents, the godparents, the church as a whole is good enough, right, for this person to be baptized. You see the difference there. So one side is about me, like my decision, what I think about Jesus, and the other side is about we, our decision, what we think about Jesus. All right, in the Anglican way, what we're doing is we're living in the middle ground. We're trying to find that space in here, right, that is not to either extreme, that is not far out on the evangelical side, and not far out on the Catholic side. So in the Anglican way, we're gonna baptize babies, right? We're gonna like say, yes, our faith is good enough. And we're gonna suggest that people need to know Jesus personally in order to be saved. We're gonna do both at the same time. Freaky, right? But that's because we're going to live on the evangelical and the Catholic side at the same time. We're going to be me and we, okay? And that's represented, I think, by this space that we hold in between. Now, here's another cool thing about that. There are Anglicans who are pretty far out over here in Catholicville, okay? And there are Anglicans who are pretty far out over here in Evangelicalville. Okay, that's okay, right? That's acceptable. Like in the Anglican way, you can be more Catholic, you can be more evangelical. That's totally fine, right? That's acceptable because we don't have because our way isn't narrow, right? And so if you like, so there are people. The baptism example is a great one. There are people who go to this church who did not baptize their babies. Right? And they say, hey, we're not going to baptize babies. We're going to wait until they're old enough to make a decision. And you know what I said to them? Fine. That's cool. Whatever. We can talk about why, you know, we, like some people do and some people don't. But it doesn't matter to me. Like it doesn't get stuck in my craw. You know, I'm not calling them up and saying, I've noticed that your child hasn't been baptized. You know? Now, there are Anglican priests who would do that, who are more Catholic-y than me, and might call you up and say, hey, why have I noticed your kid hasn't been baptized? What's up? I'm not going to do that. Why? Because I'm, you know, I'm dancing around in the middle, right? That's okay. Does that make sense? Right? Now, some people don't like that. Some people would prefer to somebody make a decision, right, and just be one or the other. And if that is important to you, then the Anglican Way may not be for you, right? Okay, does anyone have any questions about that? I'm going to try to unpack some of that probably more in the coming weeks. Oh, maybe a little bit more. But does that make sense? No questions? Oh my gosh. You're just swallowing this stuff, hook, line, sinker. That's great. Okay. Let's talk about another line. North to south. This line right here. Up and down, the vertical. I'm going to call that there to here. And I'm referring to God. Where is God? Right? Where does God live? Is God up here? Right? Is God up there? Or is God down here with me? And on the north edge, I'm going to call that for lack of a better term, the Orthodox side. Oh, that says evangelical. That's not supposed to say evangelical. That's supposed to say charismatic. In the south, the like spike at the bottom, the charismatic side. Okay? Because there are folks in the Orthodox tradition, and when I say Orthodox tradition, I specifically mean the Eastern Orthodox tradition. And this is not entirely fair about them, okay? But if you ever gone to an Orthodox church? Anyone ever Orthodox church? Okay. All right. So if you go to an Orthodox church, let's say you were to go up to Holy Trinity Greek Orthodox Church. They have the Greek festival, right? And you go and you I'm just going to tell you right now, completely overpay, right, for gyros. I don't know why people do it. All right, but anyway, I went once and I was like, what is this? And so, a $12 gyro? I don't understand. So anyway, I understand it's a fundraiser. But let's say you go into the sanctuary of the Greek Orthodox Church. Now, if you go into the sanctuary of the Greek Orthodox Church, there are doors right here, right? And there's a door over there and a door over there. These doors go to the altar area. Okay. Which one of you went up to the door in the middle and opened it and walked through? None of you, right? Because you can't. You are not allowed, right? You are not allowed to walk up to the door in the middle and open the door and walk through. Who can do that? Priests. What about the side door? Did you go to the side doors and open up and walk through? Only if you are an Orthodox man. Right? If you're an Orthodox man, it's acceptable. But if you're an Orthodox woman, it's not acceptable. Right? Because they have an incredibly high view of the holiness of God. Right? And they sort of locate God in his holiness in worship in a particular way. Right? Now, is that totally nuts and crazy? No. That's a great tradition. Like it's the second largest Christian denomination on the planet. You know, there are like 120 million Orthodox who would be like, that sounds good, right? So who are you to say, oh, that's crazy, right? I'm not going to do that. I don't want to live there, right? But that's a way, okay? That's a way. You can do that. And you can kind of have, like, God is like, you know, walls and the doors and the whole thing, right? Cool, totally fine. That's what you want to do. That's fine. On the other side, and like I said, this should say charismatic, not evangelical, there's the charismatic movement in which, like Jesus talks to me in my ear, right? And I literally have no charismatics, have spoken to charismatics, get up in the morning and say, Lord, what should I wear today? Oh, this suit? Okay, great, I'll wear that, right? Lord, where should I go to lunch, right? And Lord directs, you know, me to go to lunch. There's not a whole lot of Orthodox people praying that way. I'm just letting you know, right? They're not sitting there going, okay, God, what should I wear? Right? Because God is holy. And I'm not going to bother him, right? With my concerns about what suit I'm going to wear. All right? Now, there are a few, but, you know, because they're in the middle. But charismatic is more like that. God is here. He's very present. Here's something nuts. In the Anglican Church, we go up and down. Right? The Anglican Church has a great has lots of points of contact theologically and in practice with Orthodoxy, and the Anglican Church, beginning in the 1960s, had a charismatic revival. the effects of which are still very much present. And in fact, if you were to travel the world, the Anglican world, you would find that the vast majority of Anglicans in the world are pretty charismatic. Because the vast majority of Anglicans in the world live in Africa, which has an enormous Pentecostal influence. Right? And so, like, that's part of us too. Right? So, now, can you go nutso either one of those directions? Absolutely. And in fact, you can go nutso on any of these directions. Right? You can go totally nuts. Any direction you want. You can get, like, so charismatic that you're like, you know, you have your own new personal religion, right? I would argue that, like, Mormonism is essentially, like, a form of charismatic Christianity gone absolutely nutso, right? You could go so far, though, to orthodoxy that you're basically a deist, right? Where God is completely uninvolved, right? And he only lives in the church, right? You go so far evangelical that you never have to go. Why would you go hang out with other Christians? Me, Jesus, and the Bible. Like, right? All I have is right here in my book. You get so far Catholic that you have no personal faith at all. It's just going to Mass. That's the whole thing, right? You see what I'm saying? But in the middle of all this, somewhere in this vicinity, you're going to find the Anglican Way, which blends within itself Catholicism and evangelicalism, orthodoxy, and the charismatic movement. All blended in to one thing. And once again, there are Anglicans who are like way spiky over here, you know? And there are Anglicans who are way spiky down here. And that's acceptable, right? Because it's all part of the same package. Questions, comments, thoughts?
Thomas, if there were 10 Anglican priests standing up there in front of us, would the majority share the description that you've just put out, or would we have three going one way, three going another way, three, you know, that sort of deal?
I think that almost all of them would agree with what I just said. You know, like, I think that what you'd find is you're going to have you always have somebody who really thinks they're right. Okay? In every religious group you've ever been part of, there's always some jerk, right, who's like, well, my way, you know, and they're in every single movement. And we Anglicans, we have them too, right? And we have them on every side. We have them on the Catholic-y side, we have them on the evangelical side, we have them on the charismatic side, we have them on the orthodox side. There's always somebody, okay? And that's here's part of the problem. And I'm actually glad you asked that question, Ron, because it's something I like to mention. Sometimes people come up to me and they ask me the question, what do Anglicans believe about X? You know, whatever X is. And what I say to them is, they're asking me what Anglicans believe about X is essentially the same thing as asking me, what do humans believe about X? Okay? Because the Anglican Church is the largest Protestant denomination on earth. Okay? It's the third largest communion of churches on earth. And it has such a wide variety of people within it, such a wide variety of people who claim to be Anglican, that you will find every imaginable belief within the context of people who are going to say that they're Anglican. Now, I'm going to suggest that some of those people aren't really Anglican. I'm going to suggest that they they use the word, but they've gone off the deep end on one. They've taken one of these poles and they've gone loopy. And just because someone uses the word Anglican for themselves does not make them part of the Anglican tradition, right? Or part of the Anglican way. It just means that it's just like the same, like, you know, it's like your friend who calls himself a Christian, but also is like, I'm a Christian, but I'm also a Buddhist. No, you're not. You know what I mean? Like, you're not one of those things, you're not, and probably neither, okay? Because you cannot be a Christian and a Buddhist. They're completely, like, those two belief systems are completely incompatible. Utterly incompatible, right? Maybe you don't think that, but we could have a long discussion, okay? You can't be both of those things. In the same way, you can't be Anglican and be a Buddhist, right? But there are people who would try, who are going to say, well, yeah, I'm an Anglican, but also I'm a Buddhist. Okay, yeah, whatever. Okay, within the great tradition of Anglicanism, there are Anglicans who talk that way, but what I'm talking about here in this presentation is the vast majority of Anglicans throughout the vast majority of the world, throughout the vast majority of time, okay, there's always going to be a 1%. There's always going to be a fringe, but I don't care about the fringe. I'm not talking about the fringe. I'm talking about the the kind of the core deal. Bucky?
All right, so the distinction then between Anglicans and Episcopalians?
Is a topic for another time. I'm going to get to there, but not doing it tonight. Because every province of the Anglican Church also has its, you know, sides, and it's, you know, more complex than a simple they're this or they're that. Yeah. The genius of the Anglican Church, the great genius of the Anglican Church was Elizabeth I, Queen of England. She was the great. She was the inventor of Anglicanism, in my opinion. She wasn't the theologian, right? But she was the great genius of this thing, because what she did, she was the first person to say, "Hey, you know what, guys? Some of you are really Catholic-y, and some of you are really, you know, Puritanical or Puritans or whatever. Why don't we not kill each other and try to all be in the same church at the same time? And then if you don't do that, I'm going to arrest you," right? So, which is what you can do when you're queen, right? And so, it's good to be the queen, apparently. And so, but that's the kind of the genesis of the Anglican way, is this thing, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, which is called via media, which I'm going to define in a minute. This great genius of, you know, we can live like this together as long as we don't go too far off on the edges. And as long as we're willing to be, if we're willing to be in a church with people who don't always have the same opinion of everything, but can all worship God together at the same time, then we're going to be able to do this. And if your opinion is too strong to do that, then that's okay. You need to go to America or something, you know, but on the Mayflower or whatever. Yeah.
I should know the answer to this question.
Sure. Yes, the Church of England is part of the Anglican Communion.
They call them, because I've been there, I don't remember saying that.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a good question.
Anglican means of England.
Right, that's literally the word means of England, right. Okay, I'm going to keep going on this. So you're thinking, I know what's going on right now. Some of you are thinking hierarchy, you're thinking history. We're going to get at all those things. What I'm trying to do is give you a vision of what the Anglican way looks like, and then I'm going to try to show you like how that gets lived out in hierarchy and in history and in geography and all those different things that we think more about usually. This is a little more philosophical. Okay? So, thank you for bearing with me. Okay. I got two more axes, which I'm going to cover more quickly. One is the northeast to southwest, which I'm going to call be versus do, and which I like to refer to as contemplative to activist. What do I mean by that? So, a few months ago, I was in a Methodist church, and I was supposed to go to a Boy Scout meeting, because this kid was getting his Eagle Scout, and I was going to go watch that happen, right? And so I'm lost, because it was that Methodist church in Brentwood United Methodist, right? Have you ever been in that building? Holy heck. It's like bigger than the Green Hills Mall or something. It's gigantic, right? So I was completely lost in Brentwood United Methodist Church. And I turn the corner, and all of a sudden I'm face-to-face with an oversized African kid, but it was a poster. And there was this quote on it that said, do all the good you can, by any means you can, I don't know, something like that. And I was like, what? So I went and looked that up, and it's a quote from John Wesley. John Wesley was an Anglican priest who unintentionally founded the Methodist Church. Okay, it wasn't what he wanted to do, right? But it just sort of happened, okay, after he died. And so John Wesley was an activist. Right? John Wesley thought that it was really important for people to engage with culture. Right? He thought it was really important. He saw poverty, and he said, we need to do something about that. Right? And so as an Anglican, he did something about that. There was another Anglican named William Wilberforce, who's a lay person who brought an end to the slave trade in England, right? He was an Anglican who was an activist. He said, we have got to confront culture, right? There's another Anglican named Desmond Tutu, who got the Nobel Prize, right, for confronting apartheid in his country. Right? In the Anglican Church, there is this great tradition of activism in which Anglicans typically look at the world and say, we can make some changes, and we're going to do something about that. Right? And so there's this great activist tradition on the south, we'll put over here, okay, of the Anglican Church. Sometimes caught up in that feeling of activism is also this sense, though, of striving, right? The sense of, like, it all really depends on us. Do all the good you can. Like, let's get out there and do good, right? And so this sense of striving, the sense of, like, engagement can also be a sense of works righteousness, right? A sense of it's all about me. A sense of, like, earning credit with God in some way. On the other side, there's a great Anglican tradition of contemplation. There's a great Anglican tradition of rest in the promise of grace, right? Of the Reformed doctrine that salvation is by grace alone, right? That Anglicans also have that in us, this sense of it's okay for us not to be all freaked out about things. It's okay for us to take a step back. It's okay for me to know myself as saved by grace. There's a Anglican tradition there's a monastic Anglican tradition. A great amount of the Anglican tradition actually comes from the Benedictine monks. And so there's this, like, direct cord from the contemplative work of Saint Benedict into the Anglican communion that currently exists. And so there's that tension, though, right? There's a great tension between contemplation and action. Right? Typically. Okay? And in the Anglican Church, in the Anglican way at least, what we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out, at best, how to be contemplative activists. Right? Or how to be activist contemplatives. Right? How do we live in the tension of, I'm going to go out there and do all the good I can and recognize that I can do all the good I can and I'm not earning any credit with God by doing that. Right? I'm saved by grace. And I'm called to love and good works, right? At the same time. And there's a lot of people who go crazy off on either direction, right? There are people who are like, God doesn't care what I do, right? And there's people who are like, I better earn my way in. And the Anglican way doesn't allow for either one of those. I'm going to go on to the next one. This is the last of my little things. Stop and go, northwest to southeast. Conservative and liberal. The Anglican way involves both conservatives and liberals, right? And what I mean by conservative and liberal, I mean that in the classic sense of both of those words. Conservative, saying that what has been done in the past is important, and it's important, therefore, to stay within the tradition when possible. And so Anglicans tend to be pretty traditionalist. Have you ever noticed? Right? Right? There's something a little more traditional about this way. We have a great tradition, and we want to conserve it. And Anglicans have also always been liberal. This idea that it's okay to have free thinking. It's okay for you to explore different directions. It's okay for you to look at the scripture and say, I have a question about this, or I'm struggling with this over here. It's okay to say, like, okay, this over here, this thing we're dealing with over here, how does that deal with, what does this mean to culture today? Right? And so, in the Anglican Church, there's a conservative aspect to who we are, and there's also a liberal aspect to who we are. Now, you can go nuts on either of those directions. And I would suggest that we have some difficulties in the Anglican Church, which I'm not going to get into tonight, worldwide, and those difficulties are the direct result of folks going too far in one of those directions. Right? In this case, in the liberal direction. Like, taking, like, free thinking to the point of, like not Christian thinking anymore, you know, like going off the edge. The danger, of course, in that is that people on the conservative side rein it in so tight that they deny the liberal tradition, and then that becomes a problem too, because in the Anglican way, once again, we're trying to live here in the middle. We have no, at our best, we don't have a desire to go off on some kind of, like, liberal weirdness, but neither should we have some desire to become, you know, like conservative, like kind of like church fascists, you know, where we're going, like, tighten up, you know, batten down the hatches. So, but if there's a tension right now in the community worldwide, it's right there. Okay. So, Anglicans are evangelical, Catholic, Orthodox, Charismatic, Contemplative, Activist, Conservative, Liberals. Right? All at the same time. And just to make it even more exciting for you, I didn't capitalize any of those words on purpose. Because we are, those are great adjectives to describe Anglicans. None of them are great nouns for us. Okay? Because each of these traditions deserve to have their own noun associated with them. Like the evangelicals have their own tradition, and they deserve to be evangelicals with a capital E, right? And they have deserved to have that tradition just be theirs. Catholics deserve to have the capital C, you know, apply to them. Orthodox have deserve to have the capital O, down the list. People have the right to have their own tradition and not to have us be like stomping on it and claiming to be them. Okay? But these are great adjectives, right? These are great adjectives. For what we are. I'll give an example just to make that maybe a little bit easier. Let me just talk about, because this is one that we in Nashville know a lot about. Let's talk about evangelical with a small e versus evangelical with a big E. Okay? Evangelical with a small e means that you are, by historic standards, means you're committed to the gospel, to proclaiming the gospel, to the cross of Christ, and you're committed to the Bible as the Word of God. Those are all awesome. Yay! Okay? I'm into it, right? Anglicans are totally into everything I just said. Evangelical with a capital E typically means, in America, means Republican, usually white people, right, who vote, who are conservative in lots of aspects of their lives, right? Focus on the family, right? Billy Graham, Moody, Pat Robertson, George W. Bush, all that kind of stuff. Now, can you be an Anglican and be a capital E evangelical? Of course. There are plenty of Anglicans who are white Republicans who live in the United States and vote conservative. That's awesome. And there are Anglicans in the United States who vote Democrat, who are from Asia, who are, you know, have all kinds of beliefs that don't have anything to do with focus on the family. You see what I'm saying? That those two things are actually different. Like the evangelical with capital E thing is its own thing, and that's great, right? And you can be capital E evangelical and be an Anglican, but you can also not be capital E evangelical and be an Anglican. Crazy, right? Does that make sense? I mean, maybe it doesn't make sense, but I'll give you for instance. So, if you don't believe me, what I just said, you should totally come here during election season. And you should walk around the parking lot. And what you're going to find in the parking lot, this parking lot out here, is you're going to find bumper stickers on people's cars. And you're going to find Republican bumper stickers next to Democrat bumper stickers, next to Libertarian bumper stickers, next to Green bumper stickers, next to, like, Jesus is Lord, I don't vote bumper stickers. You know what I mean? Like, all nature of it, okay? And in this church, I do not recall ever having someone have a knockdown drag out about voting. You're not going to find any voter guides distributed in this church, okay? Voter guides, right? Like, you're not going to find, like, there's not going to be a sermon about who you should vote for or about, like, okay, everybody, we got to stop Barack Obama. He's a communist or any whatever. Like, that's never going to happen. Why? Because we're Anglicans, okay? And we are not part of one of the capital ones of these things. Like, we're not capital L liberals or capital C conservatives, okay? So if you need a church that is filled with one political party, I can recommend some to you, okay? Because they exist in our fair city, okay? This is not that church. And if that is disturbing to you, then Anglicanism will be disturbing to you, because we're gonna have disagreements in how we live out a Christian life, and that's what we do, and we think that's okay. We actually like say, "Oh, that's great," you know. I know some of you are like, "Oh, I can't take it." That's okay. That's all right. Shake it out. It'll be all right. It'll be okay. The kingdom of heaven is greater than any stupid party politics. Questions about that? Or anyone want to just walk out now? It'd be totally fine. You guys are like just eating it up. Okay. So the via media. Anglicans are centered. So I forwarded on the, you know, I zoomed in on the heart of this. Being an Anglican is awesome. Okay? It's awesome. Because you can like, the Anglican way is like, it's like this wide area in which to explore. Okay? So you grew up, you know, whatever. You grew up evangelical in some way. Like you grew up Baptist. I just made that up. You grew up Baptist. And you're in the Anglican church. And you know what? You can have your like Baptist opinions. You can be like, you know what? I feel really uncomfortable with infant baptism. Okay, that's cool. You know, I really think that we ought to, you know, go and tell our neighbors about Jesus and bring them a tract. Okay, that's cool, right? And you can also say like, I wonder what it'd be like to have an icon in my house. That's cool, right? I wonder what it'd be like to, you know, to like be a godparent for a baby. That's cool. You see what I'm saying? There's room to breathe. That's what I'm trying to say. There's room to breathe. There's room to explore. Because we're centered. There's this guy named Rupertus Meldinius. All right? Which is a great name. And as far as I know, he's only remembered for one thing. He was a reformer. And he said, in essentials, unity. In doubtful things, liberty. In all things, love. St. Augustine, by the way, never said that. He's been quoted that way all the time. But it was Rupertus Meldinius. In essentials, unity. In doubtful things, liberty. In all things, love. That is what we Anglicans call the via media. Via media is Latin. It means by the middle way. Okay, by the middle way. And we Anglicans want to live in the middle way. We want to live in the middle way between evangelical and Catholic, between Orthodox and Charismatic, between liberal and conservative, between contemplative and activist. We want to live in the middle way. That's what we're trying for. Okay, and the reason we're trying for that, this shocks some people, but the reason we're trying for that is because we really think that you can only be radical about one thing. It's really difficult to be radical about more than one thing. We want to be radical about only one thing, and that's the gospel. Okay? That's it. We only want to be radical about the gospel. And so if we're going to, like, get all nuts and fight about something and, like, fight for something, like, let's fight for the gospel. Okay? Let's get all nuts about the gospel. And all the other stuff, like who you vote for, what kind of car you drive, or where you live, or, like, how you spend your money. Okay, great, whatever. All right? We'll talk about it, but we're not going to, like, come down on that stuff. What we're going to come down on is the gospel. That's our thing. So we think that the best way to be radical about the gospel is only to be radical about that and nothing else. And then everything else. So in other words, in essentials, unity. So we want to be unified around the gospel. And in doubtful things, liberty. Okay? In all things, love. And the hardest part of this, by far, is love. That's the hardest part. Because love means that sometimes people are going to have, some people are going to think something is essential while another person thinks it's doubtful, right? And then you're going to have to love each other in the midst of that kind of tension. Okay, love is the hardest part. And love is the great commandment, right? And so we have to rely on, in the midst of like being radical about the gospel, we have to rely on loving each other if we're going to make it through this. In other words, if you're going to make it as an Anglican, you're just going to have to figure out how to love people and how to be loved by them and therefore how to like be real, how to be transparent, how to like get to know folks, like how to love the person next to you who is going to be from a different race, a different culture, a different part of town, a different like background, they're just going to be different from you, you know? And that's gonna have to be okay, right? We're just going to have to love each other and figure out how to do that. So that's what we're about. We're about that being centered stuff. Okay, yeah. No, it would not be fair to say that. The question was, is it fair to say that Anglicans are in the center between the authority of tradition versus the authority of Scripture? No, we're fully invested in the authority of Scripture. Like, we're not, that's an essential. Let me actually, I got a couple more slides. Right? We have boundaries. Because the thing about the Anglican way is, if you don't have boundaries, then everything I just said, we could be Unitarians, right? Like I could have just all that. A lot of the things I just said could be like, "And so, welcome to the Unitarian Church," right? Believe whatever you want. We don't care, okay? But we're not Unitarians. Why aren't we Unitarians? Because we have boundaries around the center. Okay, we're trying to hold the center. And so the boundaries are very important to us. So let's talk. So I say, if your Anglicans aren't crazy, that's maybe not entirely true. But we're not Unitarians. Here's how: by boundaries. Okay. So what are the boundaries? Okay. We have three traditional boundaries. The first one and the most important is the Scriptures. That Scripture is the most important boundary. The Anglicans. And once again, this is not every Anglican on earth. This is the traditional teaching of the Anglican Church throughout most of human history, throughout most of time, basically most of the places you go in the Anglican world, you're going to find people who disagree with everything I'm about to say. But most of us think this. The Bible is the fundamental authority of the church. It is the Word of God written, right? In fact, all Anglican clergy who are Anglican clergy have to testify that we believe in the Old and New Testaments where the Word of God written, and we will preach nothing contrary to it, nor require anything not found in Scripture for salvation. Okay, so the Bible is really, really important. So that's where we rest, is on Scripture. Right, so Scripture is really, really important. The Bible, number one authority. There's nothing else that is close to it. There's no equal. There's no three-legged stool. Okay, if you don't know what I'm talking about, then ignore what I just said. But it doesn't exist, right? There is no like other thing that's like, oh, the Bible plus this. No, just the Bible. Now, in that context, the second thing is the tradition. Okay, the great Orthodox tradition. In the tradition of the church helps us to understand the Bible, because the Bible comes to us in the context of the church, and the church has historically interpreted the Bible. So the interpretation of Scripture, which is part of the great traditions of the church, are also important to us, though not as important as the Bible, but they're still very important to us. And what are they? The creeds. Uh-oh. Back there. The creeds. So the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, the Creed of St. Athanasius. Specifically the Nicene Creed, which we say on Sundays. The councils. So the findings of the four great ecumenical councils, specifically the other three we have discussions about, but certainly the four great ecumenical councils. The articles, which are the 39 articles of religion. These first two, the creeds and the councils, are things that are common to us, the Catholics, the Orthodox, to basically most Christians. The 39 articles begin to, like, that's where we Anglicans begin to kind of separate and kind of stake our own space. So we have the 39 articles of religion, which are our version it's our theology, like, written down. And it's like, you should totally read it. It would take you like 15 minutes, 10 minutes. It's very short and very helpful. So the articles. The prayer book. Specifically when I say the prayer book, I mean the Book of Common Prayer 1662, which is not a book that I would typically use in worship because of the language and some other issues. But it contains the theology of the Anglican Church. And also the most recent thing was something that was written in 1888. It's called the Quadrilateral. It's our statement of what we think a Christian church is. Okay? And we think a Christian church is, in case you're interested, a church that believes in that the Old New Testaments are the Word of God, contain all things necessary to salvation, practice the two sacraments of the church, believe in the creeds, and contain the authority of the historic, what we call the historic episcopate. In other words, what we call locally adapted. In other words, there's some sort of church authority, like somebody's in charge, right? And they're in charge in line with the apostles in some way. And so that's what we're like, okay, that's what we think of as a church, right? Yeah.
So you just said in connection with the apostles.
In some way.
Or whatever, so like an independent Baptist church that has pastors or whatever, how does that fit in?
We would argue about it, depending on how evangelical or Catholic you were. People on my side of the spectrum would argue that apostolic authority, when we're talking outside the Anglican Church, can certainly be in the teachings of the apostles, not just in the direct lineage of the apostles. I'm cool with that. To say the thing is a church. You know what I mean? The thing we're struggling about is like we have no authority. There is no discipline in this church. We do whatever we want. Right? So that's what we're struggling. That's what we're trying to avoid. You know? So those are the traditions. And then finally, reason. Which you can tell this was all come up with during the Enlightenment, right? Reason. What we mean by that is the church has to take those things and figure out how to live today. Like the church cannot be a museum, right? And so we've got to figure out what does it mean to live as the church with scriptures and traditions in this world, right? And so in what ways do we need to adapt ourselves? Right? What are things that we have to hold fast to, and what are things that are like, you know, that's okay, we don't need to do that, right? And how do we roll with changes in culture? Okay, and that's the tradition of reason, which, by the way, doesn't specifically mean your reason, right? As a person, it can, but it also means the reason of the church. Like we can get together and have conversations about things, right? We believe that the Holy Spirit is still guiding us. Is what that means. Okay, so we do have boundaries. And this is, like I say, why we're not Unitarians. Okay, I'm going to hit just a couple quick other things. Purpose of the compass. Anglicans are on a mission. And what I mean by that is that, so I was talking about this whole compass rose thing, and I said at the very beginning that a compass, it's something that's on a map. Right? The purpose of the compass is to direct us somewhere. We have a mission. Anglicans, we don't believe that we're finished, right? We don't believe we're finished in our evangelism because the whole world has not heard. We don't believe we're finished in our church planting because not every person has a Christian church that they can go to. We don't believe we're finished in our discipleship, right? We don't believe we're finished in our engagement with culture. Like, we are not done yet, right? So we have a mission, and that those things that we've talked about tonight, those boundaries within that freedom, that's our way of living that mission out. Right? And so we try to figure out how we do that. I mentioned before that the Anglican Church is fairly large, 80 million people, 165 countries, and 44 independent provinces. So, like I say, the largest Protestant denomination on earth, and the third largest Christian body on earth. We're big in Africa, huge. Not so big in Nashville. Right? I'm just saying. Okay. Next week we're gonna continue with this next week. So let me tell you, this is a little uncomfortable. I'm gonna do it anyway. So people have asked me over the years, like, is there a book where you have all this stuff that's been written down? And the answer is no. I wrote a book, and it's called The Anglican Way, and it's coming out this spring. And you're going to get the ebook for free. My intention, I probably will be able to give you that book maybe even before the class is over. Like maybe within the next 6 weeks, I might be able to get you the PDF of that book. Or at least some kind of copy of it. So while we're going through this, I'm going through a lot of material fairly quickly. if you like want to read up more, this is the most egotistical thing I've ever said. You should read my book. There's lots of other books which I'm going to recommend to you, but this is as best as I could do. How's that sound? Okay, it's yours free, and it's coming soon. So, okay. Any questions anyone's dying to ask? We're right at 7:30. Okay, awesome. God bless you all. Thank you. I hope that you decide to still come next week.